In this video, you will learn how to create your own Word macro from scratch. In the previous video, we made an invoice with fillable fields, a date picker, an automatic date field, and so on. Now we will create a macro which will fully automate the calculations inside the invoice table. Such a macro will not only save the user a lot of time, but it will also make sure that the calculations are always correct. Alright, so let's start. We go to the Developer tab and click on Macros. Here we enter a macro name, let's call it table_calculation, and in the drop-down field we select the current document so that the macro is only available in this document. Then we hit create and the Visual Basic window will open. You should now see a new module in your current document under modules. And as you can see, macros often have to do with coding, but bear with me since this one will be fairly simple and I will explain everything step by step so that you will understand it. Before we start writing the code, let's clarify how we want the code to work. Obviously, we only need the table from our document. The rest of the document is not important for the calculation. We can split the table up in three different areas. The first area contains the header line and the empty line, which we don't need for the calculation. The second area contains all the product lines. Here, for each line, we will want to multiply the price with the quantity and place the result in the amount column. Note that this whole second area can change in size, as in some invoice we might have only one line, and in the next invoice it might be 8 lines, for example. The third area in our table has a fixed size again, and there we will do some more calculations in the last table column. With knowing this rough procedure, we can now start with the coding. Whenever we later on run the macro, it will execute all the code between the sub and the end sub lines. This means we have to write our code in between these lines. When we start coding, we first of all need to declare some variables and constants. Let's start with some constants. The syntax for constants goes as follows. We write const so that the program knows it is a constant. Then we write down a name for our constant. In this example, I want to create a constant for the column number of the price column. Afterwards, we need to assign a value to the constant by typing the equal sign and then giving it the value. So by writing this line, we basically created a name for the fixed value too, since we know that the price column is always the second column of our table. Then we proceed in the same way for the quantity and the amount column. As we discussed earlier, we've already split up our table into three areas, and since the top and bottom area have a fixed size, we also create constants for them. Next, we're going to declare some variables. For that, we always start with dim, then the variable name, then the word as, and then we define the data type of the variable. In this example, we have declared the new variable t1 as a table. One cool thing about variables is that we can declare multiple variables in a row. We simply separate their names with a comma and then at the end again define their data type. So, for declaring the variables, please just follow along. Later on, you will understand what we need these variables for that we created here. By the way, the data type integer is used for whole numbers and the data type double is used for decimal numbers. Now we start with the actual code. Since we want our program to work with the table from our document, we assign that table to our t1 variable. We do that by writing set t1 equals activeDocument.tables1. So this line of code searches in our document for the first table there is and then assigns that table to the variable t1. As our table can have a variable amount of product rows, we first of all have to find out how many rows our table has in total. For that, we use our number of rows variable that we created and say that this variable equals to t1.rows.count. T1 here is our table object, rows is a property of that object, and count is a predefined method that our table object can perform. So this line of code counts the number of rows in our table and assigns that value to our variable. What we will want to do now is to find out at what row our product lines start and at what row they end. Calculating the starting point is very easy. This is simply one row after all our header rows. And the number of the last product row is the total number of rows that our code already figured out, minus the fixed number of bottom rows. By knowing these numbers, we know in which line we want to start with the multiplication calculation and we will continue doing this calculation for each row until we reach the last product row. To perform such a repeating task, we will use a so-called for loop. So how this works is that the variable I starts out as the number of the first product row. Then some operations will be performed within the loop, and at the end of the loop the code jumps back to the beginning of the loop, increases the variable I by 1, and again runs the code within the loop. And this will go on until I reaches the number of the last product row. This concept will become clearer in a second. And by the way guys, if you like this video so far, please hit the thumbs up button to support me on this channel. It is only a click for you, but helps a lot in growing an audience, and in turn I'm able to create more free tutorials for you. Thank you for your support. Alright, so to calculate the amount of every row, we will need to multiply the price with the quantity of that row. Let's start with the quantity, as this one is a bit easier. We have the quantity variable that we declared at the beginning, and now we need to extract the quantity value from the current table row to assign it to our variable. We know that we have to work with the table object. This table object has a cell parameter to access each cell in that table. For the program to know which exact cell we want, we will have to give it a row number and a column number. The row number for the first product row is 3. But remember that we are in a for loop, and later on we will want to do the calculation for row number 4, 5 and so on. So instead of using the fixed number 3, we will use the variable I, as it will be incremented with each cycle through the for loop. Now for the quantity column, we simply insert the constant that we created earlier. At this point, the program knows which cell we are looking for. To get the text out of the cell, we need to add .range.text. And like that, we have now extracted the content from the quantity column of the current row. But since the code will extract the value as a text, we still need to convert this value to a number, and we can do that by using the val function. So whatever string is inside the parentheses of the function will be converted into a number if the string contains a number. And therefore we place the whole code that we wrote into the parentheses of this function. And then we continue with the price variable. We again select the cell as we did before, but this time we use the constant for the price column. Since our price always has a dollar sign at the beginning, we need to get rid of this sign. And for that, we can use the replace function. Within the parentheses of the function, we give a value to this function, which in our case is the whole cell content. Then we tell the function what symbol we want to replace, and we have to put this symbol in quotation marks. And at the end, we need to specify what we want to replace it with. So if the quotation marks are empty, then it will be replaced with nothing. It will be removed. This line of code gives us the content of the cell without the dollar sign, and now we have to convert the content into a number again by using the val function. By now we have the numerical values of the quantity and the price of the current row. With this information we can continue with the mathematical operations. The amount will equal to the quantity multiplied with the price. To place this amount value into the table, we need to access the content of the correct cell again, and then we assign to the cell the amount value. But since we want to show the amount value in a proper formatting with the dollar sign in front and two decimal places, we put the amount value into the format function and give it the correct formatting rule. Within our for loop, we will also calculate the subtotal. The subtotal will be the current value of the subtotal, which at the beginning is 0, plus the amount value. When we are in the next cycle of the loop, the subtotal will then already have a value, and then the amount of the next row will be added to this overall value. And with this, we have now finished the calculations within the product lines. The only thing left is the tax calculation and the total calculation. Since some of you might be creating invoices for different states or even different countries, we will make this tax rate variable by implementing an input box. And this is fairly simple. We say that the tax rate equals to the value that you enter into the input box. In the parentheses, we can also enter some instructions that we want to show within that input box. By knowing the tax rate, we can now calculate the overall taxes of our invoice. This is done by multiplying our subtotal value with the tax rate. And of course, we have to divide the tax rate by 100. Then the total value is the sum of the subtotal and the tax. Same as with the amount value, we have to insert our calculated values into the cells of our table. Since the number of product rows can vary for every invoice, we cannot use a fixed row number, but rather we will use the last product row variable as a reference and then increment this value by 1 so that we end up in the next row after the last product row. For the column, we again use the amount column, which is the last one in our table. Then we assign the subtotal to this cell content and format it properly again. We repeat this also for the tax and the total, but here we have to increment the row numbers further. Now, of course, we also want to show the customer which tax rate we used for the calculation, and therefore we access the cell which contains the word sales tax, and we give this cell the content sales tax together with the value of the tax rate and the percentage symbol at the end. So you can see that multiple texts or strings can be joined by using the AND symbol. With that, we finish the code for the macro. Whenever you want to execute it, you simply go into the Developer tab, click on Macros and hit the Run button. As you can see, everything works perfectly and all the numbers in the invoice are being calculated automatically. You will find a download link for this invoice template in the video description. And with this, we have finished the 3-part video series about invoices in Word. If you learned something from these videos, please support me by liking the videos and subscribing to the channel. With your support, I will hopefully be able to create more helpful videos in the future and share my knowledge on these topics completely for free. Thank you very much, and I see you in the next one.